Ladies and gentlemen, Jay Billz from Media Spotlight UK, and I've got Atlanta's finest in the building. What's going on, bro? Translee in the building.
Great to be here, man. Great to be here, for sure.
Happening, bro?
Nothing much, man. Just, you know, moving and grooving through London. It's a great place to be. Great time to be here, too.
Yeah, I can see that, because the last time you came over was like 2019?
Yeah, it's 2019.
And that was like your first time coming over?
First time coming over.
So, like, what did you take in from your first experience? Because obviously, like, a lot of people that come from the States have a lot of intrigue for the UK. So what was it that intrigued you to want to come over?
Man, so to be completely honest, places like London, coming from where I'm from, have always just been just far off fantasy land places like Peter Pan.
Watching Peter Pan last night. I was watching Hook.
That's an amazing movie. It's one of my favorite movies of all time.
Robin Williams, rest in peace.
He went crazy in that movie. One of my top five movies.
Okay.
So it was always just like a far place. But, you know, as I've grown in the music business and I've seen fans listen to music all over and people being in different places in Paris to Amsterdam to London listening to the music, it opened my eyes to we'll be there one day, you know. And you know, as we've progressed and whenever Gerald brought us out here back in 2019, it became really real. Yeah. And we got to do a lot of interviews and like really see that we have real fans and real listeners and people really rock with the movement over here too. So that's the biggest, that's a big realization for an artist, man. And we just been leaning into it.
I can see that you're messing with the UK hard because I was just talking to you off camera that you've been going to Westfields, going shopping.
Yeah.
Even like you were passing through Leytonstone and I used to live there.
Yeah, man.
I used to live there years ago just by the station. And I think like, yo, you're coming to ends?
Yeah.
You're not like just coming to like central London or that. You're coming like from the heart of what East London is, bro.
Man, we in the ends. We walking around talking to locals and just, you know, having that real London experience, because a lot of times, like you said, people go places and they only go to central London, the bougie area, and they don't really get the culture.
Yeah.
So, you know, we've been at everywhere from the inns all the way to the Queen's Palace.
Yeah.
Where this this weird pollen came out of the trees. I'll never forget it.
And Do you suffer with hay fever?
Is that what that was?
Well, I'm just asking. You said about pollen. No,
I don't really suffer with hay fever, but I do have allergies. And we were walking by the Queen's Palace, and some weird stuff came out of the trees. Some yellow, it looked like pollen, and it hit all of us. But yeah, man, we've been from the ends all the way to the Queen's Palace. So this trip was definitely a lot more fulfilling. The last time was great, but we were just interview, food, interview, sleep, food,
this
sleep.
This time we got a little more downtime.
time to like really take in the city. So,
well, let's take it back then. So let's just figure out your background, because I've been doing some research on you. So you were born from Albany, Georgia.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then you moved over to Huntsville, Alabama.
Yes.
But when did you move over to Alabama? Was it quite young?
Yes, I was 3 years old.
Oh, you were 3 years old?
Yes, 3 years old. So that's why I say I'm from Alabama.
Okay. Ultimately. So was it like a sort of family decision to move over if you was originally from Georgia?
Yes. My stepfather's job moved us. Well, yeah, once he met my mom, I was 3, they got married, and we moved to Huntsville, Alabama. Yeah.
Okay. So what's it like in Alabama? Because I keep hearing it in movies and, you know, like that. You know, I don't know if Forrest Gump had a like reference to that, but I don't know if that does it service. Do you know
Alabama.
What I mean? So coming from someone that's ignorant, that doesn't really know about Alabama, give us like a brief idea of what it's truly like there.
It's a southern city in the States. Definitely a lot of white people.
Okay.
And you know, black people have definitely found their way.
Yeah.
I think Alabama is, you know, there are some southern states that are gonna hold on to the old way of doing things for a very long time.
Okay.
Alabama's one of them. Georgia, outside of Atlanta, is one of them. Tennessee, Mississippi, they're just, you know, they're just southern states, a lot of like old history. They like doing things the old way. The police still act like slave catchers sometimes. I'm really serious.
I'm gonna get into that in a bit. Yeah
man. So, you know, it's one of those places. But on the flip side, there's a lot of good culture. There's a lot of progressive things going on. Like in my hometown, they're making a conscious effort to make the city a more cultural arts place. So just more concerts, more venues, more just things for like people to do. And they're really tapping into the culture of arts and entertainment. So I think my city is doing a lot. But just the overall state of Alabama, it's a cool place. Mm. You know, like it's it's a cool place.
And you're definitely representing, because you're like, you're going between cities as well, so you're representing both parts, so you get an idea of what it's like, not only the main towns of like Atlanta, but also knowing what those experiences are like in Alabama. So you've got the best of both worlds, really, for your sort of experiences going forward, I guess.
Exactly.
Yeah. I found out that Translee is actually your real name.
That's my real name.
A lot of people don't know. And I heard it's like generations back with the same name.
Yeah.
Like your dad and your granddad. Like,
I'm actually the third. Yes. And so that is one of the things that I'm most proud of, is that this name has a bit of history, you know. And I wish I would have been more intuitive when I was younger to ask my grandfather before he passed where the name came from, but I didn't, so I was just forced to give it its own meaning from what I think it means, and I think it means transcends all boundaries.
I was gonna think of that, because when I think of, like, you know, sort of Translee, it's kind of like giving me the transport or transcending or I don't know, just things like those sort of common words, but you can make so many meanings out of your name. So,
exactly.
I mean, it's just great that your grandfather started it all off and then it got built down. Was it just like a conscious thing to keep it going as a generational thing?
Well, when my mom and dad named me, I think it was just a conscious decision to keep the name going. I think it was just, it's a unique name.
Yeah.
And why stop it, you know?
I was going to ask it, if you have like kids in the future, you're going to, like, say a son, for example, are you going to keep that name going, Translee the Fourth?
That's a good question. I honestly don't know because I feel like I've done so much with this name that it'll be like you'll just be living in your dad's footsteps. But you know,
you want to make your own mark.
You may want to make his own mark. Yeah. Maybe let it be his middle name or something. But that'll be weird.
Okay, that'll be weird too.
So
you heard it here first. If it does happen,
yeah, for sure.
So of course, a lot of people know you that you connected with T.I. You know, you signed to Grand Hustle back in 2017. But let's take it back before all of that. Let's take it back to the Vistoso Bosses Summertime 2010. Let's take it back to the Look at Me Now cover that you did. Let's take it back to Elle, Varner and Raheem Davaughn. Let's take it back to even you tweeting Mr. Hankey, a producer, wanted to get a mixtape done.
What?
Let's take it back to those parts, bro.
Yo, this guy is crazy.
Let's take it back to those parts.
This man said Vistoso Bosses.
Vistoso Bosses. Summertime. Their mixtape, bro. 2010, bro. Man,
Chris would be flipping out if he was there.
So, funny. I mean, from those times, because obviously it seems like you were really climbing up and, you know, working on mixtapes. Even you were doing, like, Who's Translee as a mixtape from back then as well. So what was it that got you to the point of doing all those projects that led you to the point of, you know, meeting T.I.? But before we get to T.I., what led you to all of that and, you know, all of those projects that you had going on?
Man, it was one person, Mr. Colley Park. Whenever me and Chris used to come to Atlanta and network, we ended up meeting him, and he was at a point where he was at the height of his career.
Right.
And he let us come in and intern and really learn the business. And, you know, he was coming off Yin Yang Twins.
Right.
He was coming off A Bay Bay with Hurricane Chris.
Yep.
He was coming off of Soulja Boy, and he had this girl group named the Vistoso Bosses. That was his next thing after Soulja Boy.
Right.
And we were coming in as interns. He also had VIC Get Silly during that time too. But he had this girl group, and like that was one of our, like, we were interns, so like that was one of our things we had to do, was kind of take them around and like, and you know, take them to the clubs and take them to some of the things they had to do and pass out some of their CDs.
Yeah.
And then once he started taking an interest in me as a rapper, he didn't initially, but I think he felt the soul in it. And I remember he was putting out this Vistoso Bosses project, and there was a song called Summertime that I ended up getting to put a verse on. And I was so excited.
It was the end of the track, wasn't it?
Yeah. I was so excited because this was like, I was an intern, and now I'm actually being put on one of his artist's projects. So I'm like, man, he's actually viewing me as an artist. So that was a wild time.
Yeah,
I had forgot all about that song, man. I would have never thought it brought back crazy memories, because I remember the studio we did it in now and everything. Yeah. I remember asking them, could I get on it? I remember it was the whole thing. And
crazy, man. That's, I mean, even what I found out as well was that you did a song with Raheem Davaughn.
Yes.
Does Anybody Love?
Yes.
And there was a story that you actually performed it at a strip club.
Yes.
I mean, you know, the the correlation between the both must be different.
It's crazy.
Like, you know, you got strippers shaking their ass, and then you're performing like a world peace sort of tune.
A world peace song.
How did that get received so well?
Man, so it's so crazy because Kali Park, you know, like I said, Kali Park, he was coming off of Yin Yang Twins, Soulja Boy. These are records that you play in the club.
Yes.
So his whole basis. He's even a club DJ from before Mr. Kali Park. So he knows club. He knows club.
Yeah.
So when he first started working with me, I'm still making these passionate records that are just based on how I feel. I'm not making records for the club or anything. And me and Eddie Fontaine ended up making a song called Does Anybody Love Anymore?
Yes.
And it was like, Kali Park was like, this is a hit. You know what I mean? He's like, it ain't necessarily a strip club. But in Atlanta during that time, as a rapper, there was really nowhere else to work your music but the open mics and the strip clubs. So it wasn't that I wanted to do it in there, but it was just like that's literally all we had.
It's
where
like
I could
the opportunity
go.
Opportunity arose and you just took
there
it.
Was the opportunity arise every week. Gotcha. You can go perform, pay your money, perform every week if you wanted to. But it was a place to go and just get heard and to practice performing. And I'll never forget, man, doing those songs in the strip club. We was in Kamal's 20. No. And I can't even think of the name of the strip club. But
it must have been to a lot for you to almost forget.
Been a lot. Been a lot. But I just remember performing those records, man, and the ballers stopped throwing money. Like, it's like the record, like,
it's like shut down.
Snap. Yeah, oh, snap. My bad.
See, he's on business already, man. He's got a lot going on.
So let me put this thing on silent. but yeah, so everybody stops throwing money. The music stops. Everything is like, you know, it's just the wildest experience. But what that did was it made me stand out.
Right.
So
gotcha.
So the next week when I come, like, oh, that's the dude with the song.
Right.
You know
and
what I mean?
That continued on.
And that continued to just kind of snowball like around the city, because everywhere I went, I was just, and it wasn't me trying to be different. It was just, I was just speaking my truth. Everybody in Atlanta was on that stupid fruity swag. You know what I mean? And it was just like, at the end of the day, everybody might not rock with it, but it'd be like a few people in the back like, yo, I was rocking with you, bro.
Right,
you know what I mean?
Yeah,
and like,
I
fed off of that, because, you know, if I would have been looking to the people in the front row and everybody screaming, I would have quit a long time ago. So
I'm glad that you didn't quit, because obviously that led you to T.I. a couple of years later. And I heard that you and your manager and T.I. have the same barber.
Yes.
And
yes.
Were you at the barbers at the time when that happened? Like, how did the whole connection come about if both your manager and T.I. have the same barber?
Nah, man. We just, once we finished that project around 2016, man, Chris gave it to the barber and was like, hey, the next time he comes to get his haircut, just give it to him.
Okay.
And she ended up giving it to his cousin. Because if you know anything about celebrities, they're the last person that you want to get something to. Because
I've heard a lot of stories.
The best thing is...
I've heard almost punch-ups have been happening almost.
The best thing that you can do is get it to someone close to them. Even like a publicist. Like, it's better to get something to a publicist to get...
For
you want to get a song with me, it's damn near better to get it to Sophie or somebody like my manager. Or somebody that can be like, hey... And can bring it to me in a non-cluttered way versus like people just asking me to do stuff on the internet. Yeah. So, you know, it's the I lost complete track of what I was saying.
No, but it's just the vibe. It's the memories that you've been having that I've been giving to you. It's just like, you know,
it's crazy.
You're surprised that I knew that stuff. But,
yeah, it's crazy.
But obviously being with T.I. and stuff and, you know.
Yeah. So we gave the CD to him and he liked it. And literally 2 days later, we were on a call. And we've been just building and growing ever since then.
And
we
I
went
can
on
see
tour.
That.
We did a tour. We did a 36-city tour.
Wow.
And that really propelled me into a new space as an artist, just from my stage presence to just, you know, adapting to a new level in the music business.
Yeah. What's the best advice that T.I. has ever given you? Or even if from the Hustle Gang themselves, like, you know, you got Trey, The Truth, B.O.B., Tokyo Jets, any of them, like, what's the best advice you've been ever given?
So they're all great, like, to be honest. Like, I learned a lot from a lot of, especially like the OGs, like Trey The Truth, and you know, main thing from Trey The Truth is just being selfless and helping people no matter what your status is. Like, I don't know if you've noticed what he's been doing the last few years, but it's I'm talking about phenomenal, the things that he's been doing. And T.I. too, man, like, he's a big giver. He has a huge heart. And he does a lot of things around the city, around the city of Atlanta, and you know, everywhere, but a lot of things around the city of Atlanta that helps people that aren't, you know, aren't in a position that, that he's in. And like, that's a great thing. But one of the main things I learned from him, I say this all the time, man, it was this lady that we didn't like to work with back then.
Oh, wow.
And I would complain about it, and he was like, "How much you want to make in this industry? 100 million? 200 million?
I've heard that in an interview that you did recently.
What
did he mean by that?
Basically, it was, we were trying to, like, we were so focused on her not being nice to us that we were missing out on the bigger picture. Like, it doesn't matter if she's nice to you. Does she get the job done? Okay, great. You don't have to live with her. Move around. Stop letting that affect you. Because do you think you're going to make $100 million and never work with somebody that you don't like?
So makes me think, if you settle for the $10 million, then you're dealing with just wanting to be nice to people. But the $100 million is the long-term gain in terms of you're going to come across people that you're not going to like. But it's going to be long-term benefits.
Yeah, I think $10 million. 1 million, I think, you know, a lot of times, you know, like, I think that you may have come across people that you may not like, but at the end of the day, it's how you maneuver around things. Everybody's not gonna have a jolly attitude towards you. Everybody's not gonna be, you know, the same. Like, we grew up in the South where everybody's nice. You go to New York, everybody's not nice.
Right.
You know, so
New York's quite reckless.
Exactly. This is mini New York too. So this is like New York too.
I mean, I'm hoping we're not all that bad. You know what I mean? In terms of London, I mean, you wouldn't have come back otherwise.
I think people here are generally are nicer here.
Right.
Period. Gotcha. So y'all's, it may be mean here, but it's still nice to us because people are still like, "Sorry, lad," and "Excuse me, lad." Like, they
like
still,
your British accent.
Yeah, man. Yeah, I done picked up a little bit of an accent since I've been here, man.
Right. Okay. Is there an accent that you can pick up? I know it's a random question, but
what do you mean?
Is there like an accent of the like world accent that you can do?
Oh no, man! I'm not really good at accents.
I'm not good at either. Like, I'm not
because I always start merging them. Like, if I start talking too fast, I'll sound like a Mexican Brit.
Hey, listen, I got a best friend talking who's Scottish, Ebonics. And I have to tell him to kind of bring it down a bit.
Yeah.
I had like a theory I wanted to go through quickly, because one of our UK artists used to work with T.I., Chip.
Yeah.
Did you ever have that connection with Chip during the course of that? Have you ever like crossed paths? Because obviously Chip crossed paths with T.I., worked with the label for a bit, and you've been on the label for a long time. So have you ever crossed paths?
Never worked with Chip.
Wow.
Never even met Chip.
Wow.
And
did you hear about him though?
I had definitely heard about him. Mm-hmm. And then I hadn't heard about him for a while.
Yeah.
Until we came back this time. Gotcha. And I think somebody mentioned Chip.
Yeah.
Because of the T.I. thing. And I honestly I couldn't even tell you one song by Chip. I heard he was super dope.
Yeah, he is.
I personally have not heard any, and I'm going to have to really tap in and see what he got going on. I was thinking,
because obviously the whole connection, you know, why not be full circle and have you two on a track to really, like, bring it home.
Now that would be
the
dope.
Whole history, do you know what I mean?
That would be dope.
That'd be so dope.
That would be dope.
I mean, well, let's talk about current projects that you got going on. So you got your clothing brand, Inner Peace, Outer Glow.
Yes.
I'm thinking World Peace straight away as soon as I hear it.
World Peace.
The World Peace, you know, feeling, you know, it's almost like you being an activist in a way, but just through music and clothing.
Exactly.
You know, even talking about earlier where you did the song with Raheem, it kind of makes sense, like, how you wanted to venture into clothing. Like, so what got you to that point in wanting to bring merch out?
Well, after the pandemic, man, I think we all got to sit down and analyze ourselves and our inner well-being. And, you know, it was one of those things that people have been trying to get me to do merch for like a long time, and I was never moved to do it because it didn't have enough of a purpose.
Right.
Because I was never just into just selling shirts with just anything on it. You know,
some
people are like good at that, but I'm not necessarily the like fashion guy. I'm more of the passion guy.
Ooh.
So
yeah, but you got to bring the passion with the fashion, bro.
Exactly. So you know, like, that's the thing for me, is to be able to, like, clothing is the easiest avenue to get the mantra out, you know, like, gotcha. I can walk out of here and 20 people can see my shirt in 10 seconds,
obvious.
You know, so like, that's been the best way, and over in the States, people really have taken to it. So, you know, we're just trying to spread the word over here as well, and you know, try to, you know, save as many lives as we can at the end of the day, because I think if people are sitting with better inner peace with themselves. I think a lot of the crazy things that happen on a day-to-day basis where people just flip their shit, I think will slow down a whole lot of that. You know, even with these mass shootings going on in the States.
I was going to ask you about that because
every single day.
Because
now,
even when you, I saw your story yesterday, it was, I can't remember the guy's name. It was a basketball coach.
Steve Kerr.
Steve, yeah. And how passionate he was as well.
It's crazy, man. They're fed up, man. Yeah. And we everybody is. It's just, it's fed up, man. The States are so run by guns and money that it's almost like there's almost no way to peel it back.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because you got to, like, I heard somewhere there's like 350 million people and 310 million guns in the country. It's crazy.
Jesus Christ.
So it's not, it's like a, you know, like, the corniest dude on the corner now is walking around with a strap. You know what I mean? So it's just out of control.
And it's kind of like a common thing even with the UK, not necessarily guns, but also knife crime has been talked about heavily over here as well. So, you know, the media tried to portray it as lower as what it actually is. So it's nuts how things are going about, and we just need to do
See,
better.
Knife crime?
Yeah.
We could deal with that. We could deal with knife crime because once somebody come in and slice up one person, maybe two, he going to have some track shoes on to get everybody else. Like, or you going to have to know how to fight. You know what I mean? Because we can hit with the knife.
Yeah.
It's the assault weapons where you can come in and spray 60 people in 5 seconds.
Wow.
That's the problem. That And you can go and be 18 and go buy 5 assault rifles just because it's your birthday. You know, you don't have to have any mental health check, no background, nothing. Just go get it and do what you want to do with it. And that's the biggest problem. Even handguns, I don't even have a problem with handguns, because at the end of the day, you gotta, that's harder to do. It's the problem with these assault weapons where people don't even stand a chance. It's like you just coming in spraying everybody and they can't even fight back. That's the problem. That's the thing that I think needs to get curbed in America. Mental health check need to be done. But the gun companies, they're so, it's so much money, so much lobbying, so much backroom dealings with that stuff that it's just like they're about to still have a gun rally in Texas. Trump and all these people are still about to have a gun rally in Texas, I think next week or something like that.
That's bullshit.
In the light of what just happened.
Yeah, that's some
so
bullshit.
That should tell you where we at with it. And that's the type of stuff that will get him reelected by him doing that. So that's the crazy thing that
I appreciate you talking the realness. I'm just hoping that violence decreases full stop
at this point
because it's getting ridiculous now.
Me too.
You know, God has put us on this earth to live, not to die, like prematurely, let us live and stuff like that. So, I mean, obviously how passionate you are, I can see, because even with your project Freedom Summer, you know, 9 tracks, the standouts for me were Catch This Wave with T.I.
Okay.
And then Owe Me to the Game as
Owe Me to the Game, dope.
I do like those two. And even with Fist.
Yeah.
Kind of the Fist stuff that we were talking about, like BLM, I'm thinking straight away. So is it the experiences of you growing up and what you're experiencing, what you're seeing, is it just expressing like what needs to be better done or what, you know, what, because you seem very passionate about, you know, current events and what needs to be done to be better.
Man, you know, at some point in America, it just gets tiring, man. Like, it's like, you know what? I'm just going to speak my piece, push my movement, and just stay out the way, man, because it's like, trying to be woke in America, especially to be black and woke in America, is to be in a constant state of stress and confusion. Like, if you really taking in everything that happens and trying to fight it, you'll just run yourself into like an early grave, man. Yeah. So it's like you literally have to like just take deep breaths and just figure out, like, you know, take care of people around you and just, I don't know, man.
Yeah,
I don't know.
We don't have all the answers, but it seems like you're bringing a lot of the issues out on your music. So I appreciate that's happening, man. And of course, you got a new project coming out soon, Social Currency.
Social Currency,
So it seems to like to be a continuing theme, like we have done like since 2010, like, you know, rapping with purpose, not just like rapping for the sake of it.
Exactly.
Is this like a mission statement that you're going to continue your vibes of what you're bringing to the table?
Man, it's not even something that's done intentionally. It's something that's just in me. It's that's why I rap. It's to, there's things on my mind. Like, I'm not even a big talker.
Right.
Like, when I'm around a lot of people and everyone's talking and getting their ideas off and thoughts off, I'm mostly the one that's probably sitting quiet because my brain doesn't really work like that.
Yeah.
It works best when I can sit down, analyze things, and put it in rap form and get it off. So you know what I mean?
Best creative outlet. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
I hear that. I hear that. So, I mean, obviously, you're here now. You know, how long are you here for?
Man, fly back? Well, tomorrow is supposed to be the last day. We may stick around and
you might as well. You might as well.
But we're not gonna stay in London.
Oh, right.
We may stick around and hit Paris or something like that.
Okay. Okay. Get some of that French love.
Yeah. Right. So we may do that. But if not, I'll be leaving out tomorrow afternoon.
Okay. Well, before I let you go, I always do this with every artist. Let's have some fun now because obviously we've talked a lot deep here.
Yeah.
I'm a bit of a Twitter stalker.
Okay.
There's been a lot of tweets that you put out, and there's some that really stand out to me. So I just wanted to bring a few out.
Okay.
Let our audience know just for a bit of fun. Is that cool with you?
Yeah, go ahead.
All right, cool. So the first one, this made me chuckle a bit. I wish they would bring back minutes on these phones so folks won't call you with all the small talk. Totally agree.
Yeah, man. Come on, man. Because it's like people call you for things they can text you about all the time. And I saw this meme. It was like, the best time to call me is text.
Right.
I thought that was funny too. But yeah, I don't know. I think I was just feeling the way one day. I thought that was funny.
Was it just something you were feeling on the day? You were just like, so, like a lot of people were just calling you for no reason. You just thought like, oh, I'm going to put that out.
Yeah, I forgot what was going on. But it was one of those times where it's like, I wish we had a limit on this right now. So
yeah, bring back the minutes, like the old school phone methods, exactly. You know what I mean? So you have to pay more if you want to talk more.
Exactly.
In other words. Next one is, I don't mind if people who serve food continue to wear masks. I actually liked that part.
Yeah.
And it's something, when I thought about it deeply, I thought like, yeah, whatever politics we can talk about, but you know what? That kind of makes sense, you know?
That makes perfect sense.
Because like, a lot of waiters, they're around food all the time.
And they're talking like over your food.
There you go.
Like they're literally talking over the food and they're like, you know, who had the chicken, who had the rice and beans, like there's like, so I felt so good whenever they were bringing food, they had the mask on, so it's like, I wish they could keep that
comfort.
They could keep that, yeah, but it's like, I guess it's not fair to make everybody do that because it's not comfortable. You know,
I bet
so.
You go into the restaurant, so put your mask on,
put your mask on.
don't talk over my shit.
Don't talk over my food. Especially no.
That should be a new song. Don't talk over my shit.
Especially no T words, like those T words. Like,
oh yeah, the ones. Tomato. Especially where the tongue action comes.
Yeah,
into it.
Man. Yeah, because it's like,
right, you know what I'm saying.
Right. You know what I'm saying. Exactly.
All right, two more. Soon as you build a following on one app, now you got to start over on another. Just transfer my fucking followers all over the apps.
Yes.
Facts.
Yes.
Facts. And obviously with the algorithms, they're messed up on certain.
Especially with the ones that are owned by the same companies. Like my Facebook and my Instagram should be all the same. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And you know.
You know, yeah.
Yeah.
Mark Zuckerberg.
We talking to you, Mark.
To sort it out, please. You know what I mean? Trying to get my boost followers and shit. You're just keeping me on a playing field, man. Come on.
Yeah, man.
Don't bring
on
with that bullshit. Don't bring us with that bullshit. Anyway, I don't want to get cancelled out here, but
right.
The last one, and I think this is the most important, and it's quite deep, but it makes sense. A mental health therapist should be a part of a lot of these record deals.
Mm, yes.
Because I know for you that obviously when you signed to Hustle Gang, you had like T.I., a couple of the artists that you have as like support mechanisms because, you know, family, it seems.
Mm-hmm.
But obviously I get it. You know, a lot of people that sign to deals, they don't have like the directions to kind of go in.
Exactly.
And then it's like if anything goes down, like the record labels might not always be able to support you in that way. So, you know, what's your thoughts on, you know, wanting to have record deals to get help in that way?
Man, a lot of these artists, you know, even outside of me, a lot of like street trap artists, they're coming out of war zones.
Yeah.
And they've been able to make it because of their speaking their stories. But they're still coming out of war zones. And a whole lot of artists, whether it's a dangerous neighborhood or just a wild upbringing or, you know, divorce, just different things that happen in these artists' lives.
Yeah.
And they're able to speak their pain or they're able to speak their truth.
Yep.
And people like it. But that still doesn't necessarily always heal them. You know what I mean? And they're being pulled and drug around. Like, you know, we have to show up to things like this and be happy, bright-eyed, bushy-tailed.
Yeah, and that's not always the case.
And it's not always the case. And it's like, no one ever asks how you got to this point of being happy today, you know? Yeah. So I think a lot of artists, and, you know, I move how I move. I'm always doing something, always doing, you know, things like this, which I love things like this because it helps get the message out.
Gotcha.
You know, but it can be stressful, yeah. You know what I mean? And over time, especially if you're an artist that's like hasn't even made it yet, but you're still doing a lot of these grind things that's wearing you out and you're still not getting a $10 million check for it,
gotcha.
It can really wear you out. So I think that's a big thing that should be a part of a lot of these deals, especially with these labels that profit off the artist's pain. Mm. It's like, you do know that they had to go through something to even come up with these songs.
Gotcha.
So are they still dealing with that, or do you care? You know what I mean? A lot of time they don't care. It's just about,
it's like it's like an underlying issue that needs to be addressed.
Exactly. And they keep ending up in jail and doing things because they're still not healed. They're still not mentally right. You know what I mean?
And it takes time to heal.
Exactly.
Translee, I want to absolutely thank you for your time, first of all. You gave me some gems today. I like when I have conversations with people and there's something I learn on a day-to-day basis.
Exactly.
So, you know, I appreciate your kind words and everything that's been said. So thank you so much for
Thank you for having me, man. Thank you.
It's been a pleasure, man.
This has been dope, for sure.
So if you can tell our audience where they can catch you on all the socials, what's coming up for you, the floor is yours, my dude.
Yo, so my name is Translee. You can catch me on all platforms under Translee. That's TRANSLEE. You can also follow my brand on Instagram, innerpeace.outerglow. You can go there, click the link in the bio, get all your merch, get your mantras right. Get right, you know what I mean? Because this world is going crazy right now, so you need your inner peace, outer glow. My last album, Freedom Summer, is out right now. Everywhere you can look. And my new project, Social Currency, is on the way also.
So. All right. Well, I mean, also big up to the cameraman that's behind because he doing multitasking.
Yeah, my boy KP in the building.
Love to the team.
The coolest nobody in London, you know what I mean? Outside with it.
You know what I'm saying? I'm just looking 413. I'm thinking like, I got to rep the 413. I got to find a 413 cap now. So you know the one's there. But yeah, Translee again. Thank you so much.
Oh my God.
Appreciate it. Yes, and hope to see you regularly in London
Every time we come to London, we're going to lock in with you, bro.
Hey, you know what? We're going to make it happen again, bro.
Yes, for sure.
J Billz, Media Spotlight UK, Translee, transcending the industry, and we out here. Peace.